We're defending the knees, Muay Thai knees. Most people do it incorrectly. When a knee is being driven toward you, the impulse for most people is to bring the arms down and try to defend in this manner. Now, the secondary part that they do is they defend rounding out and they walk backwards. This allows the person who's actually doing the knees, so if I'm coming up into here, it allows them the continued opportunity to keep kneeing you. The defense for this is not to go backwards, but to drive into the opponent. Now, it seems a little contradictory that you're going into their knee, but if you follow the proper movement at the right time, you will actually take them off their base and they won't be able to fire the knees. It's more difficult to fire the knees, let's put it that way. Some of us, if she's pushing on me, boom, I can keep my base pretty well by hopping on one foot against resistance. We do this as part of the training. I'm actually pretty good at that, but I can only go backwards so long before I finally get caught. When she's firing knees, she captures and ties up. And if you're going like this, and I'm just backing up or staying in one spot trying to defend this, you're losing. Defending is losing in this case. You cannot do that. And in general, defense is a loss. You can't continue that indefinitely. They will wear you down by attrition. The tie-up, when the hand comes in, is the first thing that you should be dealing with. Now, a lot of times people will react because they're throwing a tie kick. So you got a rear round and they're reacting to it, or they're trying to reach it. So they go like this, and then all of a sudden she captures the head. She'll reach out with the other hand, she'll cross as the leg comes back down. So boom, they try to capture, and then you're already in a bent forward position. Yeah, keep going. And then you have to start defending. So when this comes across and you happen to get in that position where you're trying to capture a leg, trying to work for that glorious takedown, or just trying to defend, you've already compromised part of your defensive structure up here anytime you bring the hands down from the head. This comes in, boom, and you're down here like this. This sets up either for the lead hand draw for capture, or it sets up for a cross, because if you know Muay Thai, you're going from counter positions, rear round to lead hook and so forth. That's the mechanics. You're doing cross body opportunities. So you're in here, she can also tie up with that lead there. So first few things on the defense of it. When a person comes up to work the Thai capture, your first response should be up immediately. She captures me like this. I want to immediately bring myself up. If you look at how this arm is captured from this side, if I come up and posture up and turn my shoulder into it, I'm basically going like this, which is standard cover, which is what we want. This comes into play. If you do this right and they're actually putting power on this, it's gonna hurt them because it will actually start torquing the shoulder a little bit. So as soon as that comes on, that's the first thing. And then start working yourself in toward the opponent. If I go here and get captured and try to pull out, you're setting yourself up for failure. So you cannot do that. That hook comes into play whether you've caught it, trying to catch a kick, bam, she crosses over, boom, first right here, dive in. Another thing that we love to do, as soon as this comes in and touches me, you hit. That's all there's to it. Hit, either an uppercut, hit, boom, cross, punch. If you're touched on the high line, hit. Let the low line take care of the low line with your cover, with your stop kicks and things like that. Let the upper body from the waist up take care of the upper body, which means my elbows, my hands, anything that comes into this range, now I can deal with it. Do not reach below the waist. Anytime you take this cover off, see, this comes into play. If I go like this, nothing protecting home base, and you'll see that frequently. So Tie is up. She starts the plume. My first and foremost thing is posture up with the head. I rotate my shoulder in. This starts shifting her body because of the pain on the shoulder. And I don't care who this is. Anybody that gets in this position, if you're torquing your shoulder in for a natural cover just right, they're going to feel that pain, and it's not going to be a joyous occasion for them. So this comes into play. Go ahead, try to put it on tight. See, she can't because she knows it's painful. And I do this with big guys. It doesn't matter the size of the opponent. The wrist is, there's only so much torque that you can withstand. And your neck muscles have to be strong, so you do have to train. This isn't just work this technique and you'll get out. Work the musculature to make sure your body is functional under heavy stress. Then this becomes easier. So she ties up. She ties up with the other. If I'm already at this point, it's too late for me to try to work my punching, and especially if she's got good cover here. If I spend a lot of time trying to do this on the outside, she's got clear access to the knees on the inside. So I cannot sit there and deal with upper body escapes while she's trying to fire her knees, because she will get in. She can torque my head to the side, fire knee up to the head. There we go. So this is something that once this comes into play, if you can open this up, you open it by expressing your chest in, hips in. You want to get your head in line with your hips. The reason it works for them is they cap the top of the skull. So if you're looking at the structure of the plume, this is okay. This is, you know, fine for driving in. This at the cap of the skull is where the power is. The plume mechanics, if you're looking at the plume mechanics being done properly, we're looking at taking the head and we're actually rotating. If we can rotate and turn it to the side, we're actually working on only this set of muscles rather than doing two sets of muscles and having to fight the person's strength in that. If I can shift it to the side and she tries to resist and I pull, now I've got a lot more strength versus what she's got. Secondary, we're looking at my lever system. If I'm lower on the skull, where the skull meets the spine, that means she has a lot more leverage against me. So typically what you'll do is you'll cap the skull. We call it capping. So if you think of a yarmulke, you think of some sort of a cap here. This is where you want to actually secure your position for the most power. So I'm going to be able to defeat the majority of people with a cap in the proper place. Third, we like to make sure that the elbows are in tight. It's a couple of reasons. One, because I don't want her getting inside to centerline control. The other is that I start slowly closing off the carotids just a little bit. It may not seem like much, but if I'm doing this hard and they're struggling and they've got the fight to try to deal with everything that I'm doing here, the exertions, including fighting this, and they have a lower blood supply going up to the head, a little bit more constriction, it wears them down even more. So those are the things that you have to look out for on the plume itself. Now, for defending it, so when she gets in this position, if I, by chance, get in this position, which I shouldn't be in, especially if I do my posturing right and I get my hips in, bind, get nice and tight, I can get in here like this and I can lift. And I don't care how big the person is. I've done this with 270-some pound guys. When I'm coming in like this, if you get in tight, you've got your hips in just right, you can lift low on the back and you can take the legs. It doesn't take much. You just have to lift enough. So I'll pull in, whether it's chain link, whether it's hook like this, anything that draws you closer, hips in, lift with your head. Remember, just enough to lift this so there's less friction on the ground. And then I basically tap the leg. It doesn't take much. And it's really fun watching big guys go down because they don't think they can do that. You have to circumvent a wide stance. But if they got a wide stance with me like this, I'm going to drop the middle with a nice knee, and that's going to bring their legs together really quick. So now defending on this is when this is coming in like this, she's got this tight and she starts setting up for her knees. Now we do a penetrating long knee, which is very different than the up knees, but we're going to go with the up knees because that's what the majority of people will do, which is basically bringing the head down. So now I get one defense, maybe one before I better act. So if this comes into play, pop. By then I should be in. I should not sit there and stay out. I'm in, I bind, hips in, pop to here. If you're thinking about this, you're binding, you're crashing in with a headbutt, that's gonna be really the first thing we look to do. Second is, now I posture. Now I can take the hips if I want, take the leg, bump them down, and then go where I wish. The next thing is, this is coming in. I get one defense, like I said. She pulls me down. I've got one here. At this point, I'm gonna flow with that knee as it drops down. I can either shoot in here, I can bind both legs. Again, I prefer to come up to here. I don't like to put myself down in this position where I'm lower and then have to work out of that position. If I'm really good on the ground, I can draw the knees and then do the giant step around, then it works really fine. But if you've got multiple opponents, you don't want to be in a position where you're already partially on the ground. So ours is always from the perspective of, boom, one, bind. If I need this just to lift the leg and then do a pitch and shift, I can do that as well. Coming through here, bind, hips in, take the leg, throw them down, slam them down, or use them as a shield. Comes in, boom, heads, I shear it. You know, you have to be careful when you shear. If I shear like this, I will tap it off with this arm, and this one's secondary, because they've got the force of the blast coming up. If I don't have this for deflection and passing, I'm gonna shear this right up into my jaw. So, comes up, pass, and just like this, now I've got a side position on their legs. So for takedown, if that's my so desire, or shearing it, and then right there, just get back into the game for boxing. Overhands and the whole bit. So, ties up. Double, shoot, if I need, pitch, throw. If your hips are in line, you can lift a lot of heavy people. Boom, boom, shear it, off to the side. You've got a double leg, off the side, reap it. So you don't stay there a lot. You have to get comfortable in this range. Don't waste time trying to go. So she's got this bound, no knees yet. Just bound. Don't waste time trying to do all this, okay? I guarantee you, if you're doing that with me, or you're doing that with somebody else who's really well trained, while you're playing with this, they will be blasting, breaking some ribs. They're going to continue their assault. If she's got the position she's trying to cross face, I swear I will get in. So again, this does not stop this, or this.
Okay. When your arms are shorter.
Yeah. So even if my arms are shorter, I will still open her up. So it's guaranteed that if you are defending, you're losing. Make sure you don't put yourself in that position.